Harper Audio presents One True Love by Laura Lippman, performed by Linda Emond. Copyright 2006 by Laura Lippman. Production copyright 2008 by HarperCollins Publishers.
One True Love. His face didn't register at first. Probably hers didn't either. It wasn't a face-oriented business, strange to say. In the early days on the streets, she had made a point of studying the men's faces as a means of protection. Not because she thought she'd ever be downtown, picking someone out of a lineup, quite the opposite. If she wasn't careful, if she didn't size them up beforehand, she'd be on a gurney in the morgue, and no one would give a shit. Certainly not Val, although he'd be pissed in principle at being deprived of anything he considered his property. And while Brad thought he loved her, dead was dead. Who needed post-mortem devotion? So she had learned to look closely at her potential customers. Sometimes just the act of that intense scrutiny was enough to fluster a man and he moved on, which was the paradoxical proof that he was okay. Others stared back, welcoming her gaze, inviting it. That kind really creeped her out. You wanted nervous, but not too nervous. Any trace of self-loathing was a big tip. In the end, she had probably walked away from more harmless ones than not, guys whose problems were nothing more than a losing card in the great genetics lottery, dry lips, a dead eye, or that bad skin that always seemed to signal villainy, perhaps because of all the acne-pitted bad guys in bad movies. Goes to show what filmmakers knew. Val's face couldn't be smoother. Still, she never regretted her vigilance, although she had paid for it in the short run, taking the beatings that were her due when she didn't meet Val's quotas. But she was alive, and no one raised a hand to her anymore, not unless they paid handsomely for that privilege. She had come a long way. 27 miles, to be precise. For that was the distance from where her son had been conceived in a motel that charged by the hour, and the suburban soccer field where he was now playing forward for the Sherwood Forest Robin Hoods. He was good, and not just motherly pride good, but truly skilled, fleet, and lithe. Over the years, she had persuaded herself that he bore no resemblance to his father, an illusion that allowed her to enjoy unqualified delight in his long limbs, his bright red hair and freckles. Scott was Scott, hers alone. Not in a smothering way. Far from it. But when he was present, no one else mattered to her. At these weekend games, she stayed tightly focused on him. It was appalling, in her private opinion, that some other mothers and fathers barely followed the game, chatting on their cell phones or to one another. And during the breaks, when she did try to make conversation, it was unbearably shallow. She wanted to talk about the things she read in The Economist or heard on NPR, things she had to know to keep up with her clientele. They wanted to talk about aphids and restaurants. It was a relief when the game resumed and she no longer had to make the effort. She never would have noticed the father on the other side of the field if his son hadn't collided with Scott, one of those heart-stopping freeze-frame moments in which one part of your brain insists it's okay, even as another part helpfully supplies all the worst-case scenarios, stitches, concussion, paralysis. Play was suspended, and she went flying across the still dewy grass. Adrenaline seemed to heighten all her senses, taking her out of herself. So she was aware of how she looked. She was equally aware of the frumpy, overweight blonde mother who commented to a washed-out redhead, "Can you believe she's wearing Todd's loafers and Prada slacks?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.